Thank you. Welcome to our worship service this morning. Our focus today is going to be on overcoming temptation as we look at the gospel reading and how Jesus overcomes temptation. Just a few announcements for us. Lenten dinners at 5:30 throughout the season. Most of them have now been taken up by one of the groups to help cover those. I think there might be one or two left. Check with Charlotte if you're interested in supporting or having your group support one of the Lenten dinners. And then I want to draw to your attention the family game night that is coming up on Friday. Starts at 6 p.m. We're ordering pizza at 6:30. Bring your cards, bring your board games, and come on out and find somebody to play with. And it'll be a simple evening of fellowship in the Lord's house. One other thing I'll mention is we have copies of this devotional called Torn. It's a Lenten devotional, and I encourage you to pick up a copy if you have not, and spend a little time in the Word and in prayer as you consider the Lord Jesus Christ and his journey to the cross. With those announcements made, we will have the ringing of our bell followed by the opening hymn. God bless your worship this morning. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us pray. The congregation may kneel. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us make confession unto God, imploring his forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. O God, our heavenly Father, I confess unto thee that I have grievously sinned against thee in many ways, not only by outward transgressions, but also by secret thoughts and desires, which I cannot fully understand, but which are all known unto thee. I do earnestly repent, and am heartily sorry for these my offenses, and I beseech thee of thy great goodness to have mercy upon me, and for the sake of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, to forgive my sins and graciously to help my infirmities. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, hath had mercy upon us, and hath given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgiveth us all our sins. As a minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you who do truly repent and believe in him the entire forgiveness of all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. The congregation may be seated. The Old Testament reading for the first Sunday in Lent is taken from the book of Deuteronomy, the 26th chapter, beginning at the first verse. And in this reading, Israel is on the verge of crossing over from the wilderness into the Promised Land, and Moses is giving them sort of final instructions before they make this great journey. And he focuses them today on the first fruits, to show thanks offering to the Lord our God. When you come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you for an inheritance, and have taken possession of it and live in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you shall put it in a basket, and you shall go to the place of the Lord your God that he will choose, to make his name to dwell there. And you shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, I declare today to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our fathers to give us. Then the priest shall take the basket from your hand and set it down before the altar of the Lord your God. And you shall make response before the Lord your God. A wandering Aramean was my father, and he went down into Egypt and sojourned there, few in number, and there he became a nation, great, mighty, and populous. And the Egyptians treated us harshly and humiliated us and laid on us hard labor. Then we cried to the Lord, the God of our fathers, and the Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. And the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with great deeds of terror, with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. And behold, now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground, which you, O Lord, have given me. And you shall set it down before the Lord your God and worship before the Lord your God. And you shall rejoice in all the good that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house, you and the Levite and the sojourner who is among you. Here ends the Old Testament reading.
No.
From St. Paul's letter to the Romans, the 10th chapter beginning at the 8th verse. And in this reading, we're hearing how he urges us to hear the word of God and to confess that word through faith in Jesus Christ for our justification. The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Here ends the epistle reading. We now pray our gradual responsively. For he shall give his angels charge over thee,
to keep thee in all thy ways.
They shall bear thee up in their hands,
lest thou dash thy foot.
He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High
shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty.
According to St. Luke, the fourth chapter, beginning at the first verse. In this reading, Jesus overcomes the tempter through the word of God. And Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by the devil. And he ate nothing during those days. And when they were ended, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone." And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, and said to him, "To you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me. And I give it to whom I will. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." And he took him to Jerusalem, and set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." And Jesus answered him, "It is said, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." And when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. Here ends the gospel for today. Confess the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. He shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We sing our sermon. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Please rise. The text for our message is from the Gospel reading, Luke 4, and focused on verse 13. And when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. This is the word of God. Please be seated. Two girls went out into a field to play together one day, and as they were out there playing, one of the girls looked down and she noticed there on the ground this beautiful stone, and she picked it up and it would sparkle in the sunshine, and it just made her smile and delighted her. And she said, with thanks to her friend, "Look, look at this beautiful stone." And the other little girl came over and looked, and she got excited. And then she decided, the second girl, that she would find a stone like this too. And she began to look around and soon discovered that there was not another stone like this to be found. And she became quite disappointed. And she started to think to herself, "I would like that stone that my friend found." And she was devising a plan about how she might get a hold of that stone. She went and asked her friend, may I have it? And she said, no, I found it. I'd like to keep it. So the other girl found a couple stones that she liked. She thought were nice, were precious. And she brought them back and showed them to the other girl. And the girl said, "Oh, no thanks. You can keep those. I want to keep my stone that I found." Deep inside, the little girl rose up feelings of resentment. And when her friend turned to walk away, she took that handful of stones and clubbed her. Now, this is not an example of what you should do. Desire. Envy, resentment. Desire, envy, resentment. And there are other names for such thoughts and feeling. And they describe what's going on inside this little girl, what's rising up inside of her. Everybody knows, you all know these feelings. They have been with you since you were a child. They follow us into adulthood. They're from preschool to international politics, as we see too much in the news these days. Every temptation starts with the simplest of desires. Now, generally, people want to learn how to control these feelings, to control their desire, their envy, and feelings of resentment. But there is something fundamentally wrong with human beings. And we genuinely struggle in this matter. Cannot always have what we want. We find ourselves scheming to get what we want, and we hate it when we don't get it. By ourselves, we are beset by every temptation. So in our text this morning, Jesus is focusing in on these issues of temptation, the problems of desire, of envy, of resentment. And he's facing these things head on during a season of fasting in the wilderness. And to make Jesus' experience all the more difficult, Satan is personally present, there to press him, there to prod him, there to push him into sin. I want you to pull down your bulletin for just a moment and look with me at that cover that's on there. This is an artist's depiction of the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness. And as you look at the picture, ask yourself, can you find Jesus in the picture? And then can you find Satan. Can you find the evil one in the picture? For many, the difference between good and evil, between right and wrong, is often unclear. Things seem a bit blurry in this world, in this life. And that is why so often people are overcome and overwhelmed by their temptations. And this is one of the reasons that we have services weekly here at the church. It's why we gather together for Bible study, so that we can keep these things clear in our minds, to see the difference between right and wrong, the Lord and the evil one. Now, this is a little aside, but it applies. I've noticed as I'm reviewing what's happening on our YouTube channels that, praise be to God, viewing of our services looks like it's up, wonderful, but views of the Bible classes look down. And that concerns me. Because, as I just mentioned, as the Word of God teaches us, we need to stay in that Word, in that study of God's life-giving Word, which guides us and makes things clearer for us. And I believe there's something very special about God's people gathering together around the text of the Bible and having a discussion of what's taking place there. Sometimes things that seem incredibly unclear, when we get together and talk them through, they become clear, and we are strengthened in that process. It's a little bit unruly sometimes and a little bit messy as we work through it, but the benefits are great and vast. I want to encourage you to stay in Bible study, stay in the Word. Encourage one another to gather and see in the gospel today how Jesus, our Lord and Savior himself, overcomes the evil one and temptation by that Word of God. Luke tells us that Jesus, in that time in the wilderness, went through more than three temptations. Three are mentioned explicitly, but he tells us at the beginning of the verse that the temptations were existing throughout the 40 days. It was a constant thing, just as we experience temptation in life. And then he tells us in verse 13 that Satan tried every temptation, on Jesus, to try to get him to stumble. But the gospel writers record for us these three. And the first of them is about something so simple as food, as daily bread. It's the simplest desire, right? To want something to eat. And is there anything wrong with wanting to eat, to feel hungry? Of course not. Of course not. This is a completely natural desire. Of itself, there's nothing wrong with it, but in this case, Jesus has set a spiritual goal. He's praying and fasting for 40 days, and so the temptation is to think about the body rather than about the soul or the spirit, and to turn Jesus away from his spiritual goal, that message that there's more to life than the body and meeting the bodily need. The next temptation is about power. Satan, in a moment, shows Jesus all the empires, kingdoms of the world, and says, "These are mine, they can all be yours. Wouldn't you like to have them?" And this fits with Jesus' goal, isn't it? This is why he's come, that the kingdom of God might be spread to all the nations of the earth. Boy, Satan knows how to tempt, doesn't he? He knows right where the weaknesses are in our hearts, in our minds, and he goes right after them. And here he goes after Jesus. This fits with your mission, Jesus. We see this temptation at work in spades in our news here in the last 11 days, don't we? With that Russian invasion of the Ukraine, wanting power over other people, to control other people. And we all run into our own little dictators in life, don't we? No matter where we are, no matter where we serve, that quest for power and its corrupting influence in life. Jesus faces that temptation head on in Satan's very presence. And the last one is about trust in God, whether God cares, and testing God to see if He will care for you. God, who is the most powerful of all, God who is over all of creation, the ruler, almighty of all things. Satan says, put him to the test. If you won't submit to my test, put God to the test. Take a leap. And we'll see how that turns out. Satan even quotes the Bible to Jesus. He's quoting Psalm 91, which is a psalm about God's care and protection. Didn't God say this? Satan knows his Bible, and you better as well, if you want to overcome such temptation. In every temptation, Jesus answers in this way. He quotes the word of God. He cites the word of God back to the devil. Jesus obviously knows his Bible very well. An interesting thing is that everything he cites comes from the same book of the Bible. It all comes from the book of Deuteronomy, the one we read in our Old Testament reading, the one where Israel is on the verge of leaving the wilderness, as Jesus is in the wilderness of temptation, and entering into promised land, what God the Father had promised to them. Jesus is on that verge, and Moses is teaching them to make sure they have a clear sense of right and wrong, of good and evil, as they stand on that edge. Listen to the words he quotes. Man shall not live by bread alone. You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. You shall not put the Lord your God to the test. The word of God clarifies the relationship between God and man, and between Jesus and the tempter who has come to trip him up. He quotes good old Moses in each temptation. Folks, for us today, Jesus is the answer for facing every temptation and the fears that arise in us as we face those temptations. As the story shows, the story here in the gospel, we are not alone in this situation. Think about it. The opening verse tells us that when Jesus was sent out into the wilderness, the Holy Spirit, the Heavenly Father, sent his Holy Spirit to fill Jesus. It says he was filled with the Holy Spirit. Jesus was not alone. The Father was caring for him, and the Spirit was present with him. And that was a good thing, because sure as shooting, Jesus was not alone. Satan was there, right? He was not alone in this world, thinking on his own independently without those influences in his life. And take this to heart, folks. You are never alone. As Christians, you are never alone. The evil one is always there. St. Peter tells us, 1 Peter chapter 5, that he is like a roaring lion, prowling about, seeking whom he may devour. He is not going to leave you alone. But you are never alone, because in Christ,
His Spirit fills you. His Spirit is present with you. The Lord your God is watching over you. Even as that psalm that the Satan quotes to Jesus describes. He sends his angels to care for his children, his people. God's care surrounds us that we may overcome temptation as it arises in our heart. Things are not clear. And sometimes in life, for God's children, things don't seem clear. But when those experiences happen, call on the Lord your God. Call on him and ask him for his help in every temptation. When it's not clear, look to that word of God. Be instructed in the way of the Lord so that you might overcome those temptations in your life. And overcome the evil one. The Holy Spirit of God, through his word, will guide you through this wilderness and into that promised land that Jesus has gone ahead to prepare for us. Two girls went out into a field one day. And the first little girl looked down and she saw this beautiful stone, precious stone that sparkled in the sunlight. And she picked it up and she showed it to her friend, her companion. And her friend said, "Oh, that is beautiful. Thank you for sharing that with me. Let's go on and look for other stones and play." In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We continue with our offer.
Sang for him that day. It's not all about the shepherds or the bright and shining star. It's not about the wise men who traveled from afar. It's about the cross. It's about my sin. It's about how Jesus came to be born once so that we can be born again. It's about the stone that was rolled away so that you and I could have real life someday. It's about the cross. It's not just about the good things in this life I've done. It's not all about the treasures or the trophies that I've won. It's not about the righteousness that I find within. It's all about his precious blood that saved me from my sin. It's about the cross. It's about my sin. It's about how Jesus came to be born once so that we can be born again. It's about the stone that was rolled away so that you and I could have real life someday. It's about the cross. But it's the ending that can save you, and that's why we celebrate. It's about the cross. It's about my sin. It's about how Jesus came to be born once so that we can be born again. It's about God's Son nailed to a tree. It's about how every drop of blood that flowed from him when it should have been me. was rolled away, so that you and I could have real life someday, so that you and I could have real life someday. It's about the cross. It's about the cross. It's about the cross.
On the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it unto them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Congregation to come forward for the sacrament, beginning on the pulpit side. welcome to the Lord's table. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given into death for you, for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take likewise and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. The true body and blood of our Lord, strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen.
Gracious Father, we ask
your mercies this day upon the following persons: Andrea and Kirk Adler, Bill and Gwen Bostic, Carol Brown, Gail Ann Eckert, Pat Farmer, Terry Garner, Roseanne Harbage, Mickey Krieger, Bob Laird, Joan Passick, Cole Petty, Pat Simpkins, Bob Snyder, Margaret Stevenson, Peggy Underwood, Sherry Weiler, Jim Young, Mary, and Bob Timmons, that your Holy Spirit would come to them and encourage them in their time of struggle with physical needs. Help them, O Lord, to overcome each and every temptation of doubt and discouragement by looking to the Lord Jesus Christ and salvation and mercy in his name. We pray for the following households of Emmanuel: Morbitzer, Morris, Malloy, Malloy, Nasser, Newsom, Nierman, and Pastor, that they would be blessed and surrounded by your comforting angels, O Lord our God, that they would prosper in all their ways as they seek to serve you. We pray with joy this day, dear Lord, for the birthdays of Ella Howard and Michelle Bunyan. We thank you, O Lord, for their life and presence among us. We ask, O God, that you would bless the families and friends as they gather to celebrate your goodness to these women. In joy and strength in Jesus. Hear us also this day, we ask, dear Lord, on behalf of our fellow believers and also for the citizens in the Ukraine. We remember before you the Lutheran Church in Kremenz. We ask that you would grant them steadfast faith, confidence, and hope as you surround them and care for them in this time of war. We also pray for the regions of Donetsk and Luhansk that are experiencing military aggression, that they might be kept from all harm and danger. And for the Evangelical Lutheran Church of Ukraine and Bishop Sergei Mashevsky, that their hearts might find rest and comfort in Christ despite the difficulties they face. We pray for government leaders worldwide as they work together to try to bring an end to this conflict, but especially for those in Russia, that they might be inclined to distinguish between what is good and what is evil, and to follow the way of righteousness and peace, and so end the hostilities. All of these cares and petitions we commend to our Lord Jesus Christ, and through our Lord Jesus Christ, to our Father, whose name we pray, Amen. The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord. Lord, bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Be sure to greet one another as you depart, and please sing with me the closing hymn.
I am. Yeah.